Thank you so much, Heavenly Father, for another week, another time to bless you, to dig into your word and to see what it is that you have treasured here for us. I know that we will be rewarded as we break open this bread of life. And we pray that you would lead us by your Spirit. Open our eyes, our understanding. In Jesus' name, amen. Ezra chapter 3. Ezra returning and rebuilding. Ezra chapter 3 and verse 1. I think what we might do is, maybe we'll do, let's do 1 and 2 to begin with.
When the seventh month came and the children of Israel were in the towns, the people gathered as one man to Jerusalem. Then arose Jeshua, the son of Jozadak, with his fellow priests, and Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, with his kinsmen, and they built the altar of the God of Israel to offer burnt offerings on it, as it is written in the law of Moses, the man of God.
And as we look at this, I want us to pay attention to the first part of what's going on. And as we do that, let's keep in mind some things that have already taken place. So we've got the time frame. Is it just after the 70 years of exile in Babylon? This remnant has now come back to Jerusalem. And we see that there are all the representation of the 12 tribes that are gathered together. So now we have this detail. What do we see right off out of the gates in chapter 3?
They're building an altar.
Okay, so just about there. So before they're building an altar, you're right, but before they build an altar.
They went home in the seventh month.
All right, they went home. The very first thing is in the seventh month. What does that tell us?
October,
okay.
Tishri is the month of the Feast of Tabernacles.
Mm. All right, so the month of Tishri.
Which is our September, October.
Which is our September, October. Let's have a look at the screen. You have before you a calendar of the Jewish calendar, the Hebrew calendar, all right? And it begins at the top. So if this was a clock, for instance, all right, you see at the top at 12 o'clock, just to the right of that is the first month, the month of Nisan. And so they go then clockwise and go around. So we come to the seventh month. And if you just hit that once again, it'll be circles. There we go. All right, so we have the month of Tishri, the seventh month. What does that tell you? We already mentioned some things. So there's some feasts that are taking place here. So we got trumpets. We have the Day of Atonement and tabernacles, which is also known as booths. And in the Hebrew, it's called Shavuot.
No.
Oh, excuse me, Sukkot. Sukkot. Okay? So this is going to come into, it's going to factor into some things for us. In order for us to recognize what's taking place here, I want us to go back to Deuteronomy chapter 4. All right. right, Deuteronomy 4, and we're going to read verses 25 to 31. And we are ready, please.
25 to 30.
To 31, yes, please.
When thou shalt beget, when thou shalt beget children and children's children, ye shall have remained long in the land, and shall corrupt yourselves, and make a graven image, or the likeness of anything, and shall do evil in the sight of the Lord thy God, to provoke him to anger. I call heaven and earth to witness against you this day, and you shall soon utterly perish from off the land whereunto you go over Jordan to possess it. You shall not prolong your days upon it, but shall utterly be destroyed. And the Lord shall scatter you among the nations, and you shall be left few in number among the heathen, whither the Lord shall lead you. And there you shall serve gods, the work of men's hands, wood and stone, which neither see, nor hear, nor eat, nor smell. But if from thence thou shalt seek the Lord thy God, thou shalt find him, if thou seek him with all thy heart and with all thy soul. When thou art in tribulation, and all these things are come upon thee, even in the latter days, if thou turn to the Lord thy God, and shalt be obedient unto his voice, for the Lord thy God is a merciful God. He will not forsake thee, neither destroy thee, nor forget the covenant of thy fathers, which he sware unto them.
What time frame is this in the timeline of Israel's history? In the wilderness, yeah, in the desert. Now, the thing about that is, this is just coming on, just about a couple of months before they're ready to come into the promised land, the land of Canaan. But notice what Moses is telling them here. This is the word of the Lord, all right? Okay, so the Lord is speaking to them. Moses is the mouthpiece. So this is the word of God. And he's warning them and also letting them know what's going to take place down the road in their history. That he's warning them against turning away from him, from provoking him to anger. And notice what he says in verse 27. He says, if you turn away from me, this is what's going to happen. So verse 27, what does it say? Just have a look at it. You don't need to read it. Don't read it to me again. But paraphrase. What is it saying is going to, the Lord's going to do?
He's going to scatter them among the people.
He's going to scatter them. Is that what the Lord did? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we just mentioned, we just spoke about the fact that they've just returned back from that scattering. Okay? Mm-hmm. Now, this is several hundred years later. This isn't just like it's 20 years down the road. It's not like 100 or 200 years down the road. We're talking 1,000 years, almost 1,000 years difference from when God speaks this through Moses until these people are sent into exile and return. All right, so the passage of time does not diminish God's word. God does not forget. How many have ever made a promise and then you forgot you made the promise, or you made plans and you didn't write it down, and it's like the day comes and maybe the person you made plans to get together with calls you up and says, listen, are you... Oh, I forgot all about it because of the passage of time. And that might only be sometimes it might only be a couple of days, and it's hard to remember things.
You mean they're out on your porch and they're calling because the door's locked and you're...
Yeah. There you go.
No one's talking about.
This is not a personal experience, right? This is a hypothetical. Yeah, asking for a friend? Okay.
But this can also be a prophetic as far as what God did after the fall of Jerusalem, where they scattered among the nations completely, right? Not just the exile to Babylon.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're still scattered among the world, and God is calling them back now.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, so it's an ongoing bringing them back, right? Now, I want you to pay attention to another aspect that he says here in verse 29, so this is after they've been scattered through the nations, all right? So after you've been scattered through the nations, he says, here's what you're going to do. Look at verse 29. Now again, don't read it. Don't read it back to me. Just paraphrase. What does he say is going to take place? What will happen?
If you turn and look for me, you will find me.
What does that sound like?
Jeremiah.
What is it? Jeremiah. Yeah, it sounds an awful lot like Jeremiah. Jeremiah what? 29. Let's go to Jeremiah 29.
Were they not in Babylon 490 years?
Pardon me?
Were they not in Babylon 490
years? They were in Babylon for 70 years, and the reason for the 70 years was because for 490 years, the land did not experience its Sabbath rest. So every seventh year, they were to leave the land fallow. And they ignored that for 490 years. And so because of that, they would go into exile for 70 years, which is the amount of time, 70 times 7 is 490.
Yep.
So that gets your land, so that the land will have its rest.
Okay, and the 70 years of Babylon is basically the average lifespan of a man.
Basically the average lifetime of a lifespan of a man. Psalm 90 speaks about that the lifespan is about 3 score and 10, which is, that's the King James, of course, which is how long? 70 years.
That was a quick quiz question.
That was a quiz question? Yeah. So for 70 years, but it doesn't mean that they lived only 70 years. It was just, that was a generality. And we're actually going to see that they live longer than 70 years. We're going to see an aspect of that in Ezra chapter 3 tonight before we finish up. All right? So we've come to Jeremiah chapter 29. I want us to look at verses 11 to 14. And John number 1.
For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, saith the Lord, though of peace and thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. Then shall ye call upon me, and ye shall go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you. And ye shall seek me and find me, when ye shall search for me with all your heart. And I will be found of you, saith the Lord, and I will turn away your captivity, and I will gather you from all the nations and from all the places whither I have driven you, saith the Lord, and I will bring you again into the place whence I caused you to be carried away captive.
Do you see what he says? This is the very fulfillment of what he said back in Deuteronomy chapter 4. Isn't that right? It's not just the aspect that you will call on me and you will find me. There's that in there. But he also says that I will bring you back from the places that I have scattered you. This is the encouragement that the word of the Lord through Jeremiah is being given to the exiles, because this is a letter that's going to the first wave, if you will. There was 3 deportations of the Jews. Babylon came in and attacked, got some captives, brought them to Babylon. A second time, they did it several years later, and then they did it again a third time. So this is after the first wave after the first attack. And so Jeremiah is speaking this to the people that are still in Jerusalem, but he's also sending this letter to Babylon to encourage them. And he says, don't listen to the prophets, these people that come and say, oh, this is the word of the Lord, when they haven't been proven to be prophets at all. Chapter 28 speaks about that, where this guy Hananiah turned out to be a false prophet. He says, listen, yeah, you're going off into exile, but it's okay. It's only going to last a year. But he was going against the very word that already had been prophesied by Jeremiah, that it was going to be for a period of 70 years. And the Lord judged Hananiah, and through Jeremiah said, you will die before this year is out. And that's the very thing that ended up taking place. So Jeremiah says, listen, when other prophets come up and speak against this word as though they are speaking for the Lord, don't listen to them. Seek me, and you will find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found of you. What a tremendous promise that is. Did they deserve to find God? Not at all.
Do any of us?
Do any of us? That's the next leading, right? The next question. All right. So God is faithful, and 1,000 years does not diminish his word. He's not forgetful. He's not a man that he should lie. He's not a man that he should forget. The word that he speaks is as good as done before we see it come to pass. Amen? All right, so back in Deuteronomy chapter 4, we don't need to go back there now, just yet. But this is instruction for the people of Israel just before they come into the promised land. Now that's important for us to recognize, because this word of the Lord from Jeremiah 29 is a word for the people before they come back into the promised land. Right? And as they're getting ready to come into the promised land for the first time, back in Deuteronomy chapter 4, there's some parallels that are going on with them finally coming into the land of Canaan, because they've been brought out of where? What is their most significant part of their history prior to that 40 years in the wilderness? Because they've just come on to the end of 40 years, right?
Egypt.
So the Lord brought them out of?
Egypt.
Out of Egypt, out of exile. That was an exile for them, right? Wasn't it not? Mm-hmm. Where did they begin? They began in Canaan. And then they came into Egypt. So during the period of time that they're in Egypt, it was a time of exile. It was their first exile. And now, with Jeremiah speaking about these things, and they've been in Babylon, that's now their second exile. As far as Judah is concerned, the Assyrians came and attacked about 100 years earlier, the northern kingdom, and they went into exile. But this is the completion of that through the Babylonians.
So I got a question. What is exile? Exile is like they had nothing, no.
Exile is captivity.
They couldn't.
Here's what it would be. Let's make up a theoretical country, Petunia Land. All right. I don't know why, but. Say they invaded Canada, and then they made it into Heartland and Wakefield. Maybe they came in and... Pardon me?
I've seen this show on Hallmark.
Does it have a happy ending?
It was a Christmas special.
All right, so they come and with guns, they come and capture us and take us from here to Petunia Land. 1,000 miles away. It doesn't even need to be slaves. Just that we don't have access to home. We don't live in our own land anymore. That's exile. That's captivity. Okay.
They'll bring us back to them.
Don't bring me back.
God will rescue us from Petunia Land. I don't know why that's. Anyway, that was probably the most random thing I've said in a long time. Don't hold it against me. All right. Okay.
Said
your stager. Well, maybe. Okay, so listen to this. With them coming back from this second captivity now, it's the seventh month, so we're back in Ezra, all right, chapter 3. It's that when the seventh month came, there's something interesting about this. So we've already seen the time frame in which this seventh month occurs, according to us to be able to peg it to our calendar, September, October time frame. Now coming into September, October, what does that speak of in the land of Israel? I'm not talking about feasts now. I'm not talking about observances. Let's talk about season or weather. What happens in Israel coming onto this time frame?
It's a harvest time.
Harvest time?
The rainy season.
And the rainy season
begins.
The rainy season begins.
After harvest?
Well, the harvest has already taken place, and now they are experiencing the beginning of the latter rains, is what it's referred to. Okay? So in the spring, there would be light rains, easy rains if there's when there are some. So the late winter, I guess, or early spring. But at this time of year, for the seventh month, you're starting to come into the heavy rains, the rainy season.
What they call their winter.
It's what they would refer to winter. But so it's a rainy season. Now, seventh month. I want us to take a look at 1 Kings chapter 8. Are you okay doing some Bible surfing?
Should we always do Bible surfing?
Whether you like it or not, right?
Exactly.
I forget where I was
it's
going.
Good for us.
1
Kings chapter 8.
1 Kings chapter 8. Now, I want us to be aware of something. Who is the king in 1 Kings chapter 8?
Solomon
is the king. And what's going on in chapter 8? Well, let's have a look. So, let's look at verse 2.
Do what?
Verse 2.
Therefore, all the men of Israel assembled with King Solomon at the feast in the month of Ethanim, which is the seventh month.
Huh. Interesting. It's the only time you're going to see this word. Ethanim is what it is in Hebrew. Ethanim, okay? Ethanim is how you would say it in Hebrew. So this is the feast in the seventh month. Etanim. What feast? The feast is referring to the Feast of Tabernacles, primarily. Now, what's going on at this feast in the seventh month is that they are bringing up the Ark of the Covenant. To where? The temple. Because the temple has just been completed. It's interesting that the seventh month here, in relation to the first time we see it in connection to the kingdom or the temple, is here with Solomon, when the temple is being built, when it's being completed, when the Ark of the Covenant is being brought up into the temple. And when the people are being brought back from Babylon to Jerusalem, we see things taking place during the first and second chapter of Ezra. And then, after we get the details of the decree by Cyrus that they can go back and their preparations and all the provisions, then chapter 2 with the numbering of the people, the naming, if you will, the lifting of their heads, then when we see this date in the first year in the seventh month, our ears need to perk up and say, well, what connection is there to the seventh month prior to this? This is significant of what's taking place here. Etanim, what does it mean? Anyone have any idea?
Feast of Tabernacles.
All right, so that's what happens during that month.
That's a good guess.
All right, it means permanent.
Endurance,
strength, might. All right, and it means this. It is a symbolic meaning. It means the month of flowing streams. Let me pull out of there so that that can be seen. All right? Permanence. Because what Solomon is doing is that he's building a temple. And what is it replacing?
The
tent. The tent, the tabernacle. So ultimately the tabernacle, the tent of David, so both of them, right? But primarily the tabernacle, because that is what was the establishment of the worship, of what was identified with the, this is where we worship God. Now, something about this tabernacle, and we see with this temple, there's a differentiation going on here, and I want us to look at 2 Samuel chapter 7. Do you have enough fingers?
No.
2 Samuel chapter 7. We'll be making note of one thing in Deuteronomy, but we've already read it, so I'll just be making reference to it, okay? So you're welcome to go back there when the time comes. Actually, we'll be looking at it in just a moment, almost presently. 2 Samuel 7, looking at verses 5 to 7, I think it is. Yes, 5 to 7.
Go and tell my servant David, this is what the Lord says. Are you the one to build me a house to dwell in? I have not dwelt in a house from the day I brought the Israelites up out of Egypt to this day. I have been moving from place to place with a tent as my dwelling. Wherever I have moved with all the Israelites, did I ever say to any of their rulers whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, why have you not built me a house of cedar?
All right. What I want us to note here is that David wants to build him a house, right?
Yes.
But he says, have I ever dwelt in a house? What has he dwelt in? So I've not lived in a house. Look at verse 6. Since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt, but I have been what? Moving about in a tent. Moving from place to place in a tent. The word moving about is the word in Hebrew, halak. And it literally means walk. I've been walking in a tent, in a sense. Walking to and fro, throughout all the leading of Israel, not just confined in a tent, but that he's been walking, he's been moving, okay? The important thing for us to recognize is, so that the connection here with Deuteronomy 4 and verse 28, here's what the Lord said to them in verse 28. And there, now this is speaking about them going off into exile, okay, in captivity. There you will serve gods of wood and stone, the work of human hands that neither see, nor hear, nor eat, nor smell. And what it means that you will serve them, it means that these places you're going to be scattered to are going to be serving these other gods. And that's what is going to be the influence for you during that time. They are not God-fearing nations, God-fearing countries. But something incredible will take place is that God is going to take out of their hearts, in a sense, they in theory, in doctrine, they believe in one God, in monotheism, one God. But in practice, they were practical polytheists. That means they believed in many, served many gods. That they chased after the gods of this country and this nation and this people group and this tribe with the Baals and Ashtaroths, with Moloch and Chemosh and so on. And while they're in Babylon, God does something to them and works into the fabric of who they are during those 70 years, that by the time they come out of Babylon, they are now not only in theory monotheists serving one God, but in practice, they're serving one God. Does that mean that they never sinned? No. It just meant that they weren't going here and there after all of these other gods. And these gods, they can't what?
They smell.
They can't see, they can't hear, they can't
taste,
they can't talk. So they're inanimate objects. But here, we're told that God is a God that what? That walks. It's not just, okay, well, he walks. It's this picture that he's a God who is who is ambulatory, he's moving, that he's active, that he's not just a creation of man's hands. He's not a creation of man's imagination. He doesn't exist because somebody thought him up. That he exists independent of man, and that he is the one who's created us, created man. So he's moving about, the God who moves and walks, not like these dumb and deaf idols. And dumb is used there in a double sense. Dumb and dumb. Can't speak, and they have no intelligence whatsoever. Okay? Now this idea of etanim, permanent. He's going to establish, all right? So in the seventh month of Etanim, back in 1 Kings chapter 8, here's Solomon, he's built a house. God made a promise to David, where we just were in 2 Samuel 7, I'm going to establish your kingdom so that there will never cease to be your son to sit upon your throne. And he will build a house for me. Well, the immediate fulfillment of that is Solomon. But Solomon doesn't fit all of the details of this covenant, that he's just one who is a shadow of the one who is the greater or the great son of David, who of course is
Jesus.
And he has indeed and is building a house for the Lord. And what is that house? Look around. Yeah, it's us, you and me. And so this is a house that is permanent. It endures. It's a house of strength. And it's speaking of it was established in the month of flowing streams, as it were. What does flowing streams speak of? Life, right? Flowing streams. Moving water. Flowing streams speaks of life. And so we have this idea of permanence, and a normal course is what the Etanim is coming back to the normal course. In Exodus chapter 14, that in verse 27, you're welcome to come along. I'm just going to go ahead and read it here. So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the sea returned to Etanim, or Etan. Etan is a form of this word, Etanim. So Etanim is the plural, Etan is the singular. It returned to its normal course. It returned to its usual or constant position of a stream or a sea. It returned to its normal place. So it returned to its normal course, and when the morning appeared, and as the Egyptians fled into it, the Lord threw the Egyptians into the midst of the sea. So this just gives us a concept of this idea of the waters that had been parted, they were gone for a period of time, right? It's like on the calendar, the Jewish calendar. The waters have been gone for a time. And now in the month of Tishri or Etanim, the waters are returning back to its normal course, so that the waters, the streams, are beginning to flow once again. Waters flowing once again has an important connection for us in this. Jesus spoke about waters returning to its normal or intended course in the Gospel of John. John chapter 7, and I'd like us to go there, all right? John 7, and we're looking at 37 to 39.
John 7, 37 to 39. Now on the final and most important day of the feast,
Jesus stood, and he cried with a loud voice, "If any man is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scriptures has said, from his innermost being shall flow springs and rivers of living water. But he who speaks here of the Spirit, whom those who believe in him were afterward to receive. For the Holy Spirit had not yet been given, because Jesus had not yet glorified.
Not yet been glorified?
Because Jesus was not yet.
Was not yet glorified.
Yeah, was not yet.
Okay. Do you see what's going on here? On the last day of the what? The feast. Back in First Kings 8, it said in the month of Etanim, the seventh month, during the feast. And then here we've got on the last day of the feast. What feast is being spoken about here?
The Feast of Tabernacles.
How do we know that? It's a good guess. How do we know that?
It's the only feast in the seventh month.
It's the only feast in the seventh month. How do we know we're in the seventh month? Go back to the first part of chapter 7 of John, and we see it in verse 2. Now the Jews' Feast of
Tabernacles
or Booths was at hand. So his brothers are saying, are you going to go up to Jerusalem at this time? Because it was mandatory for the Jews to go to Jerusalem for three feasts out of the year. Which feasts? So the last one is Tabernacles. The first one is, more specifically, it was referred to then as unleavened bread, which took in Passover, but it would be referred to as unleavened bread. And then the third one, or the second of the three is, so we've got unleavened bread, then we've got the Feast of Harvest or Weeks, and then the other one that was required for them to come was the Feast of Tabernacles. And so if you're going for Tabernacles, you're going to be also there for, you look at the map or at our calendar once again, if you're there for Tabernacles, you're also going to be there for, let me come back to it here. You're going to be there for trumpets and for Day of Atonement. Because they're only 10 days apart. Okay? And if you're there for unleavened bread, you're also going to be there for Passover.
Tabernacles starts on the 15th. Trumpets is the first.
Okay, so not for the Day of Atonement. You've got a tenth. So, all right. So you've got about a week and a half. You've got 2 weeks there. So you may be going in time for Feast of Trumpets, but you're definitely going to be there taking in Yom Kippur. I mean, if you are going to Jerusalem for the Feast of Tabernacles, you're definitely going to be trying to get there in time for the Day of Atonement. So do you see what Jesus is saying here in John chapter 7? On the last day of the Feast of Tabernacles or Booths, in the month of Etanim, he is speaking something here. If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink, and out of his innermost being is going to flow flowing streams, living water. What? And the source of the living water is?
Jesus,
by the Spirit of God who will dwell in us. He says he's speaking about the Spirit for those who believed in him would receive, because the cross is yet future when John 7 is happening. Not when John wrote it, but when John, the time of which John is speaking this or recording it. For as yet the Spirit had not yet been given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. So do you see that Jesus is the fulfillment of what they've been anticipating with Solomon's temple, and now coming back at the second from the second captivity from Babylon. Do you remember Jeremiah 16 and Jeremiah chapter 23? No more will they say, "The Lord who brought us up out of Egypt," but they will say, "The Lord who brought us up out of the north," being Babylon. And Jeremiah 23 specifically is the one that's speaking about the righteous branch, the Messiah who would come. And here he is in John chapter 7, saying that I am the fulfillment of all that had been spoken about me in the Scriptures. This is what he did on the road to Emmaus with the two disciples. It's what he did with the rest of the disciples for those 40 days between his resurrection and his ascension. All right, let's come back to Ezra chapter 3. The rest of those references, I think we're good. You can take the markers out if you dare. It's in the seventh month, the month of Etanim, that they come together from all of the towns, and they're gathering together where? In Jerusalem. Because this was the mandate. They were to come together to Jerusalem. Now, they've come from a long distance. They've come from Babylon. But upon returning, they didn't return in the seventh month. They returned earlier in that year, that first year. They returned several months earlier, and they began to settle in Jerusalem and towns around Jerusalem. And now that the seventh month has arrived, we know it's got to be after Passover. And they've arrived after Passover and before the arrival of Tabernacles. Because we're being told they're coming to Jerusalem for this observance. And they're coming to Jerusalem how? I don't mean by what mode of transportation, but by what description? They're coming together as what?
As one.
As one. What does that sound like?
Unity.
Unity. It sounds like what God did through the cross, what he would do through the cross. We're talking now, in looking back, what God did through the cross, what he would do through the cross looking forward from Ezra's time, bringing them together as one man. In Acts chapter 2, after Jesus ascended, so 50 days after Passover, we're told that all of the disciples were together in one accord. Speaking of, it's in unity. And literally the word there is they're all together in him. In him. That's a literal reading of the Greek there. They're all together in unity, all together in him, one accord. And then we have in Ephesians chapter 2 that he's taken the middle wall of division between the Jews and the Gentiles, between the circumcised and the uncircumcised, and through the cross he's what? He's demolished that middle wall of separation, and he has made them what? Any idea what it says? One what? One, yes, one in Christ. So unless we're there and looking at her, you're familiar with the passage. It says, made them one man. Interesting. They were gathered as one man to Jerusalem. And this is all just in the first verse. There's a lot going on in one verse. I hope we're going to get through the end of this chapter tonight. We'll see. Our goal isn't to get through the chapter. Our goal is to see where the Lord is going to open our eyes, right? All right, so we've already read the second verse. And Do you recall what it was regarding? What did they do? Zerubbabel, Joshua, they're doing something so that the, and his fellow priests are coming together and they're doing what? They
built the altar.
They built the altar of God. The temple is not yet constructed. The temple's not even started to be constructed yet. Remember, it lies in ruins. But the first thing they do upon the Feast of Tabernacles is that they gather together at the site of the temple. And they build something. What's the first thing they build?
An altar.
An altar. So they built not just an altar to God, but they built a definite article. They built the altar of God. Now, in Exodus chapter 20, God gives instructions to the people that this is how you are to build an altar. This is before the temple instructions are given. This is before the altar is described that would be connected to the temple itself. This is, when you build an altar, make sure that you don't build steps, make a ramp, so that when the priests go up upon it, that they don't expose their nakedness. When they build the altar, that it's not to be made of hewn stones. It's to be, because the altar is not to have anything of the work of man's hands. It's to be natural stones. And so to bring that together. So this is what they were doing, is that they were building the altar of God. And it's hearkening back to when their ancestor first came to this very land where they are now. Which would be whom?
Joshua.
Okay, he's one of their ancestors. Who predates Joshua for coming to this land?
Oh, Abraham.
Abraham. And where did Abraham come from?
Mesopotamia,
which is the region of? Pardon me? Babylonia. So Babylon, but more generally speaking, Babylonia, which is the land that they've just come from, right? God calls Abraham out of Babylonia, Ur of the Chaldeans, Mesopotamia, and calls him out of that worship of other gods. Joshua chapter 24 speaks of that very clearly. I think we looked at that last week, didn't we? Did we deal with Joshua 24? If it wasn't last week, it was the week before. I know that we... let's refresh our minds so that we're all on the same page here. Joshua chapter 24. And we'll read verses 1 to 1 and 2. 1 to 3. It's 1 and 3. All right. So we are at Melissa, I believe.
Yes. 1 and 3.
1, 2, 3. Sorry. 1, 2, 3.
When Joshua assembled all the tribes of Israel at Shechem, he summoned the elders, leaders, judges, and officials of Israel, and they presented themselves before God. Joshua said to all the people, "This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Long ago your ancestors, including Terah, the father of Abraham, and Nahor, lived beyond the Euphrates River and worshipped other gods. But I took your father Abraham from the land beyond the Euphrates and led him throughout Canaan and gave him many descendants, and I gave him Isaac. And to Isaac I gave Jacob and Esau. I assigned the hill country of Seir to Esau, but Jacob and his family went down to Egypt." And I went beyond 3, didn't I? Sorry.
That's all right. So he brings Abraham out of Mesopotamia, Babylonia, and what does it say about the gods?
They worshipped other gods.
They served other gods. And notice at the very first part of Joshua 24, Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to where? Shechem. And what's significant about what he's telling them there at Shechem? Abraham, our forefather, God called him out of Mesopotamia, He worshipped other gods, and God brought him to this land where we are now. But where is, when we pick up the story of the account of Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, where is it that God brings Abraham to, or Abram at this point in time in Genesis 12? He brings him to, when we pick it up in chapter 12, where is he? Shechem. He's in Shechem. Abraham comes to the land of Israel, and where we first are told about him, he says, the Lord says to him, I'm going to bless you and make you a blessing. Whoever blesses you, I will bless. Whoever curses you, I will curse. And then we read Abraham went as the Lord told him, and Lot went with him. He was 75 years old. He went from Haran. He took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and their possessions, and so on. And they came, when they came to the land of Canaan, verse 5, Abram passed through the land to the place at Shechem, the very place that Joshua has gathered the people together in Joshua 24. And he says, I want to remind you about Abram. And where we first are introduced to Abram is that he's coming into the land, and where he settles at the first occasion is at the very place where Joshua has gathered the people together to address. And what does he do at Shechem? Abraham passed through the land to the place at Shechem, to the oak at Moreh, or I believe that it also could be called this terebinth tree. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. Then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your offspring, I will give this land. And that's where Joshua is addressing the people. And then in Ezra, where are they? They're not in Shechem, but they're back in the land. Because the place that takes preeminence over Shechem will end up becoming Jerusalem. And what does he do? He says, to your offspring, I will give this land. And what did Abram do? Take a guess. What did he do?
He built an altar.
An altar there to the Lord who appeared to him. He built an altar there. When he comes to the land, what does Abram do? He builds an altar to the Lord. He pitched his tents and he built his altars. When he would move to another place, he would build his altar and he would pitch his tents. Lot got in trouble because he ended up pitching the altar and building his tents, in a sense. Pitching the altar, meaning, you know what it is to pitch? It's like, oh, get rid of it, right? Pitching it away. So the altar of the Lord, just one second, I need to check one thing. All right, Deuteronomy chapter 12. Deuteronomy chapter 12.
Verses 5 and 6.
Todd, please.
You shall seek the place that the Lord your God will choose out of all your tribes to put his name and make his habitation there. There you shall go, and there you shall bring your burnt offerings and your sacrifices, your tithes and your contribution that you present, your vow offerings, your freewill offerings, and the firstborn of your herd and of your flock.
All right, so the Lord says that, okay, don't worship the Lord in just any way you want. When you come into the land, the Lord is going to set a place apart. He's going to call it by his name. He's going to place his name there. What's the name of that city? What's the name of that place? Jerusalem. And so he says that when you come, that you're going to seek the place, and there you shall bring your burnt offerings. You're going to make an, you're going to make a, he's going to make his habit, his place his name there and make his habitation. So it's there that they're bringing these offerings, these sacrifices. So they're fulfilling what it is that God had told them to do here in Jerusalem. And they had observed it for many years, for 350 years that the temple had been standing and the place of worship until Babylon came and destroyed it. And now here they are coming back to this very place, to the very plot where the temple had stood 70 years earlier. And now they're worshiping the Lord, having built the altar. I mentioned another place. Abram had gone, after he left Shechem, he went in chapter 13, he went to Hebron, the oaks of Mamre, and he built an altar there at Hebron, which incidentally was the first place where David established his kingdom before he conquered Jerusalem 7 years later, and then that became the capital of Israel. Let's come back to Ezra chapter 3 and verse 3 now. All right, we've got an option. Two options, I should say. We can finish off to verse 7 tonight, or we can stay an extra time and we can finish off to the end of chapter 3. Like an extra hour and a half. we'll aim for finishing off at verse 7 tonight. All right? Maybe verse 6, we'll see. All right, verse 3. Let's read verses 3 to 6. Right here with Brian.
And they set the altar upon his basis, for fear was upon them because of the people of those countries. And they offered burnt offerings thereon unto the Lord, even burnt offerings morning and evening. They kept also the Feast of Tabernacles, as it is written, and offered the daily burnt offerings by number, according to the custom, as the duty of every day required, and afterward offered the continual burnt offering, both of the new moons and of the set feasts of the Lord that were consecrated, and of every one that willingly offered a freewill offering unto the Lord. One more verse?
One more, yes, please.
From the first day of the seventh month began they to offer burnt offerings unto the Lord. But the foundation of the temple of the Lord was not yet laid.
All right. So they've come to Jerusalem as was the command. So I'd mentioned they were to come for three feasts. And we find that in Deuteronomy chapter 16, verses 16 and 17. And when you... If you're going to go away for the day, if you're going to go away on vacation, what do you do with your house?
You lock it up.
And
turn off the water.
And turn off the water and then lock the house. Yeah.
You're never going to forget that, are you?
Never going to forget that, no. Word to the wise. If you don't know our situation, not getting into it, but if you're going away for any length of time, more than a day, turn off your main water supply. Yeah. Floods can happen otherwise. Just leave it at that. Okay. When they left their towns, when they left their homes, they didn't have a police force that they could say, hey, would you mind coming by and checking my house? They didn't have neighbors to say, hey, I'm going to be gone for about 10 days or 2 weeks or whatever the travel time was going to be. Would you mind keeping an eye on my place? Why? Because there wasn't a police force, and the other, they couldn't ask their neighbors because?
They're all there.
The neighbors are all there. And if the neighbors aren't coming with them, then you don't want those neighbors that are staying behind watching your place, because they're not going to be watching it, they're going to be casing it. Right? Because if they're not coming to Jerusalem, what does that give you? What does that tell you about those that who are your neighbors? They're not observing the commands of the Lord. So if they're not observing the command of the Lord to go to Jerusalem, do you want them watching your house? No. Now they're coming back to Jerusalem, and who's in the land now? Before them, in those last 70 years, what's happened to the land? It's been desolate, but it didn't remain uninhabited. Who's living in the land?
Samaritans.
Pardon? Samaritans are living in the land in the northern part of Israel, but they have meandered throughout Israel, yeah, in 70 years. Who else?
Critters,
yeah, lots of them. What other kind of people groups?
Some of the Canaanites that weren't dislodged.
The Canaanites that were not dislodged over the time that they were in the land, that had formerly been subservient to Israel, what do they do now? Right? So do you want them looking after your house while you're gone to Jerusalem? Probably not. So what are they doing here? They're trusting the Lord. Do you notice what it says? They went. They built the altar of God of Israel to offer burnt offerings on it, as it is written in the law of Moses. So, what did they do? They said, "Guys, we need, whatever we do, have this open in front of us. Open this up. We need to consult this. We're not just going at it, just shooting in the dark, hoping we're going to hit something. We're opening this word. We're opening this truth, this light, because otherwise we're in for trouble." And it says that they set the altar in its place. Why? For fear was on them because of the people of the lands. In other words, because of the people of the lands, and that means they weren't Jewish. That means that they weren't the ones taken into captivity. These are the ones that, squatters, if you will, in a sense. All right? Trouble. And for because of the fear of them, they said, "Listen, we have no other option here but to trust God. We need to trust God. What other option is there? There's no other option. We trust God or we die. We trust God or we do it our own way. And if we do it our own way, we're in trouble. Period." And that's what got us into the mess that we've just come out of. Because we decided to do it our own way. So fear was on the people of Israel because of the people of the lands. But they weren't going to ignore the commands of God. Because logic says, you know what, it's safer if we stay home and keep an eye on our properties. It's safer if we stay where we are, because if we leave, who knows what's going to happen to our newly acquired homes, our newly acquired properties. But they said, you know what? Yes, there's reason to fear, but we're not going to trust in that. We're not going to try to secure ourselves by reducing the risk. We're going to secure ourselves by fastening ourselves steadfastly to the Word of God and the one who promised it, the one who established this Word. So, they kept the Feast of Booths. Did they keep the Feast of the Day of Atonement?
Probably, because they were following the word.
Probably. Yeah, they would have liked to have had, but they couldn't. Why?
Some of them were unclean.
Some were unclean.
Temple.
There's no temple. What is the Day of Atonement? It's the priest, high priest, takes a sacrifice, the bullock for himself, and he goes, takes the blood into the what?
The Holy of Holies,
the Most Holy Place of the temple. How do you do that if there's no temple? You don't. And then he would then offer the sacrifice of the goat on behalf of the people, and doing the same thing, going into the most holy place, the Holy of Holies. And you can't do that. So they can't do that until the temple is built. How long before the temple is built?
20 years.
Should only be whatever time it would take to build, but their enemies have come and put a stop to the work. We'll get that tonight for sure. Here's what they do. They begin to worship. They decide, we're going to worship God. Is it scary? Yeah, because we don't know what's going to go on. But we don't have the power. This is beyond our control. And if we try to control everything, we're going to drive ourselves crazy. God is the one who is our provider. God is the one who is our strong tower. He's our security. He's the one who makes this land secure and its inhabitants. So we will trust in Him. And if things happen, they happen. We trust Him in the midst of it, and He will work it out for His glory. So this is where they are. They say, we are going to worship. We're not holding back. Because otherwise, they stay home. I can worship God in my own house. Well, yeah, but that's not what God said. God said, you are to come to this place where I've placed my name. But there's no temple. He says, well, you got to start somewhere. This is the place where my temple stood. This is where my temple is going to stand. Come here and start with what I've called you to do. That's to come and worship. So come and don't build your houses. Don't stay in your paneled houses. Come and build an altar. Start there. Because what have they been without for the last 70 years?
An altar.
An altar. And without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness of sins. There's no remission. And so this was anticipating what is still yet to come, future for them. And that is the ultimate sacrifice, the once and for all sacrifice, Jesus. So, they're coming and bringing the regular burnt offerings, the freewill offerings. From the first day of the seventh month, they began to worship the Lord in this way. However, the foundation of the temple of the Lord was not yet laid. So, what did they do? All right, we've begun to worship the Lord in this manner. Now, let's get down to business of rebuilding the temple. What needs to be done first?
Foundation.
Got to start with the foundation. So they had to clean up some of the mess and then start with the foundation. And so they gave money. Let's read verse 7, and then this is where we're going to finish off tonight. So verse 7.
So they gave money to the masons and the carpenters, and food, drink, and oil to the Sidonians and the Tyrians, to bring cedar trees from Lebanon to the sea, to Joppa, according to the grant that they had from Cyrus, king of Persia.
Does this bring to mind any other events?
Yes, in Solomon's time.
Solomon's time. What comes to mind?
He asked for the builders and masons from Tyre to come and help and bring their wood and stuff.
Exactly. So 1 Kings chapter 5. I want you to pay attention to what's going on here. The connections, all right? 1 Kings chapter 5. And as we read it, I want you to just make a mental note, like a checklist. You can be flipping back and forth between Ezra 3 verse 7 and and these few verses in 1 Kings. Corey, please. Verses 6 to 11. Sorry, oh, 6 to 11.
Okay. I was looking on the board, but I didn't see anything.
What was it, chapter what?
5. 1 Kings 5?
6.
6 to 11.
Okay. Now therefore command you that they hew me cedar trees out of Lebanon, and my servants shall be with your servants, and unto you will I give hire for your servants according to all that you shall appoint.
All right, just pay attention for a second. Back in verse 7, they're giving money to the masons, the carpenters. They're giving food and drink to the Sidonians and Tyrians to bring what? Cedars from Lebanon. Now have a look at this screen just for a moment, will you? So we've got Sidon, we've got Tyre. So the very top, Hun is, that's Tyre, above that is Sidon. So Sidonians, the people of Tyre, and are the Tyrians. And so there, this red path is where they would be bringing the cedars to the coast at Tyre or Tyre, and then they would float them down. Okay, let's keep reading.
For you know that there is not among, excuse me, for you know that there is not among us any who can skill to hew timber like unto the Sidonians. And it came to pass when Hiram heard the words of Solomon that he rejoiced greatly and said, Blessed be the Lord this day, which has given unto David a wise son over this great people. And Hiram sent to Solomon, saying, I have considered the things which you sent to me, and I will do all your desire concerning timber of cedar and concerning timber of fir. My servant shall bring them down from Lebanon unto the sea, and I will convey them by sea and floats unto the place that you shall appoint me, and will cause them to be discharged there.
All right, stop there just for a moment, please. Sorry for the interruption. Come back to 3 and verse 7. So they're going to the latter part of verse 7. So they're going to bring cedar trees from Lebanon to the sea to Joppa. So we have the same detail being brought to us here in verse 9. Of it says, to this place you will direct. But when you look at the parallel in 1 Chronicles, you find out that it's to Joppa. This is the place where the port will be. And then they'll take it by land from Joppa inland to Jerusalem. Continue, please.
Okay. And you shall receive them, and you shall accomplish my desire in giving food for my household. So Hiram gave Solomon cedar trees and fir trees according to all his desire. And Solomon gave Hiram 20,000 measures of wheat for food to his household, and 20 measures of pure oil. Thus gave Solomon to Hiram year by year.
All right. And so coming back to verse 7 of chapter 3, they gave money to the masons and the carpenters, and food, drink, and oil to the Sidonians and Tyrians to bring the cedar trees. Doesn't that sound like what Solomon did with Hiram, with his men that he's taking care of? So he's paying him, and he's looking after the workers so that they've got what they need for their supplies for food. So the connections, they're not just random stuff that's happening here. It's happening according to the word. You see, what happened under those, like Moses? What happened with Abraham? What happened with Solomon? All right, Lord, lead us. We need to know your direction here, and this is what they do. And it's lining up item for item, line by line, detail by detail, isn't it? And it's all pointing forward to Jesus when he will come. And who is, do you see what Hiram says about the king? About what he says about Solomon verse 7. He said, Blessed be the Lord this day who has given to David a wise son to be over this great people. Hiram is talking about Solomon, but this is a foreshadowing of Jesus, the one who is the great son of David, the wise son to be over this people, given his life. And so we'll pick this up when we gather together again next week.